Thank you for joining us for Almost Persuaded. My name is Alan Hall. I'm the pastor of Good News Church in York, Pennsylvania. If you have your Bibles today, if you'll turn to the book of 2 Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1, that is at the back of your Bible, a few pages back from the book of Revelation. But 2 Peter chapter 1, we're going to begin reading in verse 3. And I want to speak to you on the subject today of kindness, how we as believers should put on this garment of kindness. And it's found here in a list of virtues that Peter, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, wrote down for us here in these verses. So let's begin reading in verse 3. It says, "According as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge or temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind, and cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his old sins." The late Irma Bombeck once wrote about a time when she says that she absolutely got tired of listening to people. She said it all started when she was listening to her son one day go on and on and on about a movie that he had just seen. And he had to explain every minute detail, she said, punctuated, she said, by at least 1,000 you knows and okays. Next, she got several phone calls from people that just, she said it was just mindless chatter. There was no point to the conversation. They just kept going on and on. She said it was a genuine relief that she could finally tell her last caller that she had to hang up because she had to catch a plane at the airport. And so she hung the phone up, she grabbed her bags, and she went and got in a cab to take her to the airport. She thought to herself when she sat down in the cab, "Yes, I've got about 30 minutes that I can just kind of relax here and just kind of chill out for a while." But the cab driver happened to notice who she was. And so he begins to talk to her and tell her about his son who had gotten a scholarship to a particular college and how he was making straight A's. And again, just went on and on, and she was kind of a captive audience there. She had to listen. Well, she got to the airport, she checked her bag, she walked to her gate, and she found that she was a whole 30 minutes early before it was time to board. And so again, she thought to herself, "I'm going to just take a book out here, I'm going to read it, and I'm just going to just enjoy the silence." But no sooner had she gotten the book out and opened it up, there was an elderly lady that came and sat down right beside her. And the elderly lady looked at Irma and she said, "You know, I bet it's cold in Chicago." And Irma didn't even look up from her book. She said, "Yeah, it probably is." And the woman continued. She said, "You know, my son lives there." And Irma said, "Oh, yeah, is that right?" Again, not looking up from her book. She said, "You know, I haven't been there in many years, but I bet things have changed." And again, Irma, not looking up, hoping that the woman would, you know, take the hint, you know, that she didn't really want to talk. But the woman continued to talk. She said, "You know, my husband's body's on this plane." And Irma immediately perked up and she began to listen. She said, "My husband and I were married for 53 years, and I don't drive anymore, but that funeral director, he was so nice to bring me to the airport today and drop me off." And Irma said, "You know, here was a woman who didn't want any money, who didn't want any counsel from her. All she wanted was somebody to be kind enough to her to simply listen." And Irma continued to listen to her the rest of the time until they finally called them to board the plane. And when they got on the plane, Irma says she sat in one section and the lady sat down in another, a different section. And as she was hanging up her coat, she heard the elderly say, an elderly lady say to the person that was sitting beside her, "You know, I bet it's cold in Chicago." But the fact is, there are people like this woman all around us. You know, so many people who are bearing the burden of grief or fear or just plain loneliness, who just, you know, whose greatest need of all is for believers like you and me to simply put on this next garment that Peter talks about, this garment of kindness. Unfortunately, so many of us get sucked into this me first mentality that our world lives by. You know, we're not trying to be nasty or mean or anything like that. We just don't have time to be kind. You know, we've got things to do. We've got places to be and people to see and things to accomplish. And we got to finish our list today. And so we don't have time to be listening to other people or to take the time to be kind to another. And many times it can get to the place where we consider other people nuisances or people that are just bothering us. So what is the result? The result is kindness has become a rare thing today. I think one of the factors for this loss of kindness is the fact that our world is becoming more and more impersonal. You say, what do you mean? Well, just kind of think back. Some of you can remember this years ago when you had to go to the service station to get some gas. Service station. That's kind of interesting. That kind of dates me a little bit. But anyway, we would go there and we would drive up to the pump, and here comes a service attendant. And he would come out and he would pump our gas. He would check our oil. He would wash the windshield. And there would be a conversation that would happen there. You know, we might talk about the weather, or we might talk about the sports or our families or whatever. But what do we do today? We drive up to the gas station. We get out. We pump our own gas. We slide our card through the card swiper there, paying for our gas, and we hop back in the car. We're on our way. We never talk to a single person. You know, when we call a business today, most of the time we don't get people on the end of the line. We get an automated message. If you want to do this, press 1. If you want to do that, press 2. If you want to do something else, press 3. And a lot of times you can do the whole business transaction without talking to a single person. You know, if you need some money, you know, you don't have to go inside a bank to get money these days. You go up to the ATM, you slide your card in, you punch in your PIN number, and there's the cash. You know, you get the never talking to a single person. I remember years ago when neighbors would visit other neighbors in the evening, and you would see them out on the front porch or out the front yard and maybe sipping lemonade together, and the kids playing in the yard and catching lightning bugs. And it was just a time of getting to know one another and catching up and just enjoying one another's company. You rarely see that today. I mean, you can have neighbors living right next to you or down the street, and you don't have a clue who they are because people don't get out and visit as much as they used to. Even when we use our cell phones to communicate with one another, most of the time, we don't dial a number and actually use our communication in a voice-to-voice conversation. No, most of the time we text or we email to get our point across. Again, all of these things, I'm not saying that these things are wrong or bad or anything like that. I'm just saying that we live in a world that has become more impersonal. And so the opportunities to be kind, you know, have diminished somewhat because of these things that I just mentioned. But the need for kindness, I believe, is greater than it's ever been. So how do we go about putting on this garment of grace called kindness? Well, let's begin by defining what kindness is. The Merriam-Webster's dictionary says that kindness is the quality or state of being gentle and considerate. Philip Keller says, kindness involves finding ways to brighten and cheer the lives of others. Rick Warren says that kindness is love in action. And I believe I like that definition the best because kindness is much more than just a feeling that we have. It is doing something that will make a difference in another person's life. Think of it this way. Kindness is an active wear kind of garment. In other words, it's something that Christians put on to actually live out our faith that we profess to have. The Greek word for kindness is krestos, C-R-E-S-T-O-S. And here's something that's very interesting. Krestos is only one letter away from the Greek word Christos, C-R-I-S-T-O-S, difference in the E and the I there. Now, the word Christos with the I is the word for Christ. In fact, when the early church began, those who were unbelievers often were confused with those two words, Krestos and Christos. And they just assumed that the early Christians were simply a group of people that believed in being kind. Well, that's not too far from the truth, is it? Because as Christians, as believers, that should be something that we're striving for all the time, to show kindness. Following Jesus means that we're like him, and he certainly was kind. Jesus said in Matthew 25 that on Judgment Day, we're going to be judged whether or not we were kind to others. So we're not talking about a minor issue here. We're not just talking about something on a, you know, a cafeteria style type of thing where we can go and pick and choose what to put on. No, this is something, kindness is at the heart of Christianity. It's essential in the process of becoming more godly, to becoming more like Jesus. I think all of us would agree that God has certainly been kind to us. I mean, he's kind to us all the time, isn't he? Titus 3:4 says, "The kindness and love of God, our Savior, toward man appeared not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration, renewing of the Holy Ghost." The prophet Nehemiah wrote this. He said, "Thou art a God ready to pardon, gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness." The question for us today, we know God is kind. We know that Jesus was kind. The question for us is, how kind am I? You know, how kind have I been, you know, over the last week? How kind have I been in my life? Well, I want to help you answer that question today by giving you four groups, talking about four different groups, and I want you to see which one of these groups do you belong the most in. All right, so let's talk about the first group. Group number one. This is the group where most never have put kindness on before. In other words, these are the people who are harsh. These people are quick to judge, quick to criticize. These are the folks that walk around with a chip on their shoulder most of the time, whether it's at school or work, or whether it's standing in the checkout lane at, you know, the supermarket, or driving their car around town. You know, they got a chip on their shoulder. Everybody's out to get them, and they're critical of everybody and everything. These are the folks that wake up on the wrong side of the bed almost every day. And these are the folks, by the way, that we try to steer clear of most of the time, you know, because they'll take it out on us if they're having a bad day, if something bad has happened to them. And so you kind of try to steer clear of these folks. But, you know, try not to be quick of a judge here as you think. Have you ever known anybody like that? Do you know anybody like that today? C.S. Lewis wrote this, these words that I'm about to read to you from his book called Mere Christianity, and they're so convicting. Just listen to what he says. He said, "For those of us who are a little better at kindness in our lives, it's easy for us to look critical at people below the line who have this unkindness streak in them. It's pretty easy for us to feel superior, to look down our noses at them." But then he goes on to challenge us to stop and wonder, what made this person so unkind? What made them this way? You know, there's an old saying that says, hurt people hurt people. Hurt people hurt people. In other words, if they've been hurt, if something bad has happened to them, they tend to take it out on other people that they come in contact with. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not justifying people being mean or being critical. Or being harsh to other people or doing bad things to other people. I'm not justifying any of that. I'm just saying that more than likely there is a reason for them to act that way. In other words, something has led up to that point. So when somebody's unkind to you, instead of putting them in their place, instead of trying to be unkind back to them, why not just take a moment and say, you know what, I wonder what made them that way. I wonder what made them feel like they need to hurt me or to criticize me in that matter. You know, C.S. Lewis says this, we don't know where they started their journey. You know, we don't know what they've been through. You know, they might have had alcoholic parents who took their anger out on them when they were just a child. They may have had a time in their life where they've been physically abused. They may have some kind of physical ailment that they're dealing with that is not apparent as we look at them. You know, some people today walk around with constant pain all the time, and it drives them, and it's a real struggle that it drives them to actually pushing people away, being critical and judgmental to other people, and taking it out, their hurt on others. You know, maybe they didn't have parents like you did when you grew up. Maybe they're just overwhelmed because they're forced to deal with the results of things that they had nothing to do with. In other words, they're dealing with the consequences, and they never had any part in what caused those consequences. You just don't know. You know, you don't know what brought them to that point in their life. And the fact is, understanding and kindness go hand in hand. Because the more you understand somebody, the kinder you tend to be to them. In other words, if I find out that a person is unkind and maybe they're dealing with cancer, you know, I'm going to have a tendency to understand them a little better and to not take it that personal when they're unkind. You know, again, it goes hand in hand. Have you ever done this? Have you ever been sitting in a line of traffic? You're right behind the person that is in the very front, and, you know, the light is red, but then it turns green. And green means go. But that person in front of you is just sitting there. And immediately, most of us, this is what we do. I'm going to make that guy move. And so we shut down on our horn, and we let that guy or that gal have it by blasting them. You know, we think we're going to move them on their way by really giving it to them. You know, some people will even yell stuff at people that's in front of them, you know, or make some type of gesture toward them, you know, just really act ugly because they didn't go when they were supposed to go. You know, we do those kind of things more so if we don't know that person. What if that was your mom sitting up there in the car? Or, you know, a brother or sister or somebody from the church, maybe the pastor sitting up in that car, would you do the same thing? Probably not. We'd probably be kinder because we've gotten to know that person. So what is the point? You know, there's an old saying that says, if your words are soft and sweet, they won't be as hard to swallow if you have to eat them. And the point is this, let's be kind whether we know the person or not. If we meet somebody who's not very kind to us, then let's just ask God to help us to understand that person, or at least help us to be more patient in dealing with that person. By the way, isn't that the way that God deals with us? I mean, Psalm 103 says, like a father pitieth his children, so the Lord pitieth them that fear him, for he knoweth our frame, he remembereth that we're dust. God deals with us in that manner all the time. That's the way we ought to deal with other folks. Group number one, I hope you're not in this group. The group that hasn't put on kindness yet. Group number two, those who've learned that putting on kindness is important. These are the folks who've decided that just because we're having a bad day, you know, or have something bad happen to us, it doesn't give us the right to say and do unkind things. I mean, just because someone's mean to us, it doesn't open the door for us to be mean back to them. We've learned that grumpiness is never justifiable. To put it plainly, it's when we learn that it's never right to be a jerk. It's saying, you know what, I'm going to do my best to do things, to do everything without murmuring or complaining. Ephesians 4:32 says this, be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven us. That's the verse I believe ought to be on our lips every day when we get up. You know, today I'm going to be kind. Today I'm going to be tenderhearted. Today I'm going to forgive others. Why? Because God's forgiven me. It's never right to be otherwise. So are you in that group today? But then there's group number three, those who have realized that putting on kindness is a better way to live. It's more than just seeing that it's important to do and to being kind every once in a while. No, this is how this group lives. It's realizing that kindness actually pays off. Kindness may not necessarily increase your bank account. I'm not talking about paying off in that way, but the benefits of being kind are always worth it. And sometimes it brings benefits that we never even think about. In the early 20th century, there was a poor Scottish farmer. It was called Farmer Fleming. And he was working in his field one day when he heard a cry coming from a nearby bog, and immediately he dropped everything that he had. He ran toward the bog, and there he found this young boy trying to fight his way out, trying to fight from keep him from going under. And so Farmer Fleming did what only, you know, a caring person would do there. He waded out into the bog. He grabbed the young man, and he pulled him out to safety. Well, the next day, Farmer Fleming's farm there drove up a carriage, a very nice, expensive carriage. And out of that carriage stepped a very wealthy nobleman. Now, the nobleman wanted to speak to Farmer Fleming, and he said, I'm the daddy of the little boy that you pulled out of the bog yesterday. And he said, I wanted to thank you, and I want to repay you for your kindness. And so Farmer Fleming said, oh, no. He said, I'm not going to take anything for that. You know, I did what any caring, kind person would do in that situation. By that time, there was a young man that stepped out of the Farmer Fleming's old rundown house that was there, and the nobleman noticed, and he said, is that your son? Farmer Fleming said, yeah, that's my boy. And the nobleman said, let me ask you this. Let me give you a proposal. What if he were to come with me? And if he comes with me, I'll give him the finest education that money can buy. I'll pay for it all. Won't cost you a dime. Can I do that to repay you for what you've done to my son? Well, the farmer thought about it for a moment, and he said, you know, I'll never be able to give a good education to my son. So he agreed to it. And so Farmer Fleming's little boy went away with this nobleman, and he received one of the finest educations that a young man could receive. He graduated from St. Mary's Hospital Medical School in London. He became known throughout the world as Sir Alexander Fleming, the discoverer of penicillin. But you know, that's not the end of the story. You see, years later, the nobleman's son came down with pneumonia. And guess what saved his life? Penicillin. But that's not the end of the story either, because the nobleman's name that stepped out of the carriage that day was Lord Randolph Churchill. His son's name was Winston Churchill. Yes, that Winston Churchill. You see what one act of kindness did? It had far-reaching effects, all the people that was touched by that one act of kindness. The biblical principle is this: we reap what we sow. Jesus said this, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And so the question is, why wouldn't we want to be kind? You know, one of the simplest ways to prove this principle is simply by smiling at people. Have you ever noticed that most of the time when you smile at somebody, they smile back? Usually when we feel good on the inside, we smile on the outside. But do you know that scientists have found that the opposite is also true in some way? They say when you smile on the outside, it actually helps you feel better on the inside. And so what happens when we smile at somebody? They smile back. We are actually helping that person feel better on the inside. I encourage you, wherever you go this week, try that. Try just smiling at folks for no reason and watch what happens. Showing kindness, I tell you, it's an incredibly powerful thing. And when we put it on, we're going to find it's the best way to live. So are you in group number 3? How about group number 4? Group number 4 are those who look for opportunities to display kindness. These are the people who are always looking for out-of-the-box ways to show kindness to other people, even to those who are never kind to them. They do this because they understand what God's done for them. They didn't deserve God's kindness, but God sent His Son anyway. I mean, all of us deserve death. All of us deserve eternal punishment for our sins, but God sent His Son to die for us on Calvary so that we could know forgiveness for our sins. That is an out-of-the-box way of giving forgiveness, showing kindness. And these are the folks that have realized that. These are the folks that the Apostle Paul talks about in 2 Corinthians 5:15, where it says, they don't live unto themselves, but unto Him which died for them. In other words, they're not really doing the acts of kindness for the person they're being kind to. They're actually doing it for God. They're doing it in His name. And so they're constantly doing things out of sacrifice, you know, things that cost them something, things that are unexpected in order to show kindness to other people. You know, I read a story about an auction that was being held to raise money for a school. And one of the items up for bid was a purebred puppy that just melted the hearts of the people that were there. Two in particular, there was a man on one side and a woman sitting on the other who just had to have this puppy. And so the auctioneer began the bidding, and the bids kept going up and up, and before too long, everybody else dropped out. It was between this man and this woman. And you could tell it was all over their face. They were going to get this puppy. They were in it for the kill, you know. They were going to beat this other person in the competition, and they were getting red in the face and, you know, just really kind of showing themselves in their bidding. I'm going to get you, you know, kind of thing, back and forth. And the bids went higher and higher and reached several thousand dollars until finally the man just relented. And he said, "We'll just let her have it." And the woman, after the auctioneer pronounced, "Going once, going twice, going three times, sold," received this reward for all of her bidding. This little puppy, tail wagging back and forth. Well, she did. She suddenly realized how she had acted. And she realized that everybody around her had seen. I mean, she had never intended her neighbors, her friends, those who knew her, that she never intended for them to see this pit bull side of her come out of her. And so she immediately became embarrassed. And she thought, "What can I do to correct this?" And so she stood to her feet. She walked across the room where the man was sitting. And she took that puppy and she put him in his lap. She said, "Here, he's yours." Now that's out of the box, isn't it? I wonder what would happen if you did something that kind to your competition. I want you to think about that for a moment. Who is your competition? Who is the one that gets under your skin? Who is the one that is, you know, pretty regularly being unkind to you? What could you do to be kind to that person who does you wrong? You know, what if you were kind in an out-of-the-box kind of way to that boss who's always grumpy, who's always complaining about the job that you do, always finding fault? What if you were kind in an out-of-the-box way to your own spouse? You know, that maybe says harsh things, who maybe criticizes or nags or whatever. What if you did something kind for a neighbor who talks bad about you, or the coworker that stabs you in the back? What if you actually lived out Ephesians 4:32? What would happen in your world? What kind of a far-reaching effects would it have if you were to intentionally get up each day and you say, "You know, today I'm going to be kind one to another. I'm going to be tender-hearted. I'm going to be forgiving one to another." Why? Because that's the way God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven me. God's been kind to me. It's the very least I can do to be kind to others. So I encourage you today, look for ways to be kind to other people through a smile, through a gesture, through a kind word, whatever it is. Put on kindness, as Peter has taught us to do here in this first chapter of 2 Peter.